Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. I'm very glad to be here and thankful to meet all the interesting projects and people at this conference. I would like to invite you to some kind of thought experiment in the next 30 minutes, the experiment of a queer anthropology of ambiguity. So, in my report, I firstly want to ask the question, why a queer anthropology? And in a second step, I deal with the concepts of queerness and ambiguity as two possibilities to question normativity in an existential way. And after that, I'll give a really, really short insight into Tillich's ontological concept of life to amp the first function of life in his system, in system theory terms, in a further step. Finally, it will be necessary to clarify the significance of a queer anthropology for systemic pastoral care. To come to the first question, no? Why a queer anthropology? Theory of pastoral counseling is grounded as well as on systematic theological reflections as on institutional commitments. Most current German Protestant theological ethics continue to propagate a predominantly binary gender model on the basis of which heterosexual partnership and marriage are the preferred model of Christian life. The discriminatory potential associated with adhering to heteronormativity and gender dualism prioritizes and hierarchizes people based on their sexual orientation and their gender identity. In my report, I want to adopt new theological perspectives to explore the communicative potential of the gospel to prevail against discrimination. Paul Tillich's ontological reflections on the concept of life might be helpful to introduce a queer anthropology. With respect to Tillich, it seems possible to argue that human nature cannot be understood other than ambiguous or maybe even queer. Furthermore, in pastoral care, we try to follow Tillich's demand to help humans to achieve full self-affirmation, to find the courage to be, whatever that means, and to support them in a sensible actualization of potential being. But how should this succeed in the service of an institution which clearly articulates the primacy of heterosexual orientation and way of life? In October 2017, the so-called Marriage for All was declared legally binding by the German Parliament. This includes the government's commitment to legally acknowledge, protect, and encourage same-sex partnerships as well as heterosexual marriages, for example, through tax benefits, adoption rights, and other more. A long overdue decision which also put pressure on the Protestant Church in Germany to position herself on the subject of marriage for all. Short explanation, in Germany, a church wedding requires civil union. A clear commitment has remained until today. It was left to the individual regional churches to decide for themselves who would like to perform the church wedding of same-sex couples and who not. For the longest time, discussion focused on arguments not to emotionally overstretch conservative and biblicist church members who threatened to break away from mainline churches and not to offend the Roman Catholic Church and endanger sensitive ecumenical connections. If one Googles the term combination EKD, it's the short form for the Protestant Church of Germany, and homosexuality in the search engine today, one ends up to the contents of the EKD guidance, Living with Tensions, from a paper from 1996. It states, among other things, that homosexual pastors, only men, have to acknowledge the role model of marriage and family And they have to refrain from propagating the same-sex partnership as an equal or even superior model. Furthermore, homosexual pastors, yeah, and that's a really dark, dark part. It's, yeah, I'm sorry. Furthermore, homosexual pastors need to be aware that some parents are worried about the risk of seducing or influencing their adolescent children. The fact that these statements continue to be accessible as a public statement of the Protestant Church of Germany on homosexuality and church on their homepage demonstrates, in the best case, yeah, that questions of gender and diversity are not given too much importance. In 2016, the EKD delivered another guidance which propagates the acknowledgement of civil union of same-sex couples under the headline "Challenges." Yeah, This tendency and the further propagation of a binary gender model with all its consequences is also noticeable in most current systematic theological literature. And it doesn't get better, I think. Eilert Herms, for many years one of the leading systematic theologians in German-speaking countries, describes family as a social uterus and makes it clear that the homosexual partnership cannot be recognized as equivalent simply because of the argument of reproduction. These statements can be found in his three-volume systematic theology from 2017. It's not middle-aged, but 2017. But there are also pleasant exceptions. In 2006, the theologian Isolde Kahle from Bochum published the first German comprehensive theological reflection about the binary gender model with the title "There is no longer neither man nor woman, theology beyond the gender dualism," pointing the way until today. Following Kahle, Klaas Hüsing, a theologian from Würzburg, also doubts gender dualism in his ethical reflections on sexuality. Also Peter Dabrock mentions or delivered an article with the title "Why Heteronormativity Should Have Not the Last Word in Ethical Questions" from 2017, I think. No, 2016, sorry. To sum up, we can say that there are progressive positions on the subject of gender and diversity in the German Protestant theological area, even if it's only a few. Nonetheless, the arguments still seem answer predominantly the question by a negative semantic, for example, by reflecting why non-heterosexuals must be not be discriminated. For this reason, it seems sensible to think about a queer anthropology that understands queerness as an anthropological basic constant. By this, it seems possible to overcome a binary gender model as well as heterosexual marriage as a normative concept of Christian life. The appropriate instrument seems to be the concept of ambiguity, Tillich develops, among other things, in his ontological reflection on the concept of life. Queerness as ambiguity, an existential question of questioning of normativity. The following explanations are based on a broad understanding of queerness. In my view, it seems sensible to understand queerness as a character of being inherent in every human life. Accordingly, I would like to understand queer as an anthropological basic constant, to broach the understanding of Gerard Loughlin, or referring to Gerard Loughlin, quote, "Queer seeks to outwit identity. It serves those who find themselves and others to be other than the characters prescribed by an identity. It marks not by defining, but by taking up a distance from what is perceived as the normative. By contrast, straightness in the sense of measurable, repetitive, normative uniformity does not seem to me to be a real option in the human horizon of experience. In addition, it does seem queer to speak of straightness, or weird to speak of straightness in terms of internal processes such as the sexual desire of a person. Following the ideas of David Halperin, it should be added that not only the questioning of normativity can be considered as an essential feature of human existence, but also the manifoldness of possibilities of existential realization. Quote, queer describes a horizon of possibility whose precise extent and heterogeneous scope cannot in principle be delimited in advance. In this respect, the term queerness itself appears as a performative that questions normative reality and exposes the human self-justification, in a theological understanding, as it meets us, for example, in propagating a heterosexual marriage as the preferable Christian form of life, as illusory. The following considerations focus on the question of whether queer can be understood as ambiguous. Paul Tillich propagates a dialectical understanding of life as ambiguity, which seems to exclude pure dualism as a possibility of human experience as well as the possibility of a one-dimensional nature of human beings. Life, a quote, life is neither essential nor existential, but ambiguous. In his view, every human experience is ambiguous, and that means that every human being participates on essential and existential being always at the same time. And now I hope you can read it. I try to make a picture of his understanding of essential and existential being. Tillich distinguishes three types of being: the being itself, the essential being, and the existential being. While the being itself is to be assigned solely to the infinite sphere of God, the concepts of essential being and existential being are elements of the finite sphere, which is constituted by the interaction of essence and existence. These two are the main qualifications of being which underlie Tillich's whole system. He further distinguishes different types of essences, but only these ones which have the potentiality to actualize themselves are part of life. Quotation: potentiality is that kind of being which has the power, the dynamic, to become actual. For example, the potentiality of every tree is treehood. Those which become actual subject themselves to the conditions of existence, such as finitude, estrangement, conflict, and so on. This does not mean that they lose their essential character, trees remain trees, but they fall under the structures of existence and are open to growth, distortion, and death. We use the word life in this sense of a mixture of essential and existential elements. In anthropological terms, that means that every human being has an essential nature which is only partially actualized, or in other words, existentially realized. The prerequisite for this realization, or the transformation from essential to existential being, called Tillich the finite freedom of humans, rooted in their ability to speak and thus in the ability to conceptually create their own world and make existential decisions. Moreover, the finite freedom of man is grounded in the existential quality of life, of bearing death and non-being as a possibility at all times. The social dependence of humans is a further criterion that limits their freedom. To sum up, how the three terms ultimately relate to each other can be understood in Tillich's view as follows. The being itself corresponds to God and thus to the ground of all being. The being belongs to the finite sphere, which is constituted by essential and existential being. Man can only participate in the sphere of God through interaction with true religious symbols. To gain a deeper understanding of the importance of ambiguity for human life, it seems to make sense to take a closer look at Tillich's concept of life. As we said, Tillich calls the actualization of potential being life. For that, he differentiates three functions of life and their ambiguities: self-integration, self-creativity, and self-transcendence. According to this concept, every life process in which actualization takes place has three elements. So, what's the next? Self-identity, self-alteration, and the return to oneself. Self-identity, in an anthropological understanding, means the state of an intra-psychically experienced congruence of thinking and feeling in the center of a person. With respect to Tillich, the center of a person is to be understood as a psychological self. The self-integration of life in the psychological realm includes the basic movement of going out of itself and returning to itself in an immediate experience. The center of a being under the dimension of self-awareness can be called the psychological self. Self in this sense must be understood as the point to which all contents of awareness are related insofar as I am aware of them. Human self-awareness results from the ability to objectify oneself. This objectification finds its expression in the movement of the going out of and returning to itself, in interaction with the surrounding. All acts which go out from the personal center are related to the environment as receiving it and reacting to it. Self-alteration takes place in the context of a going out of itself while also maintaining self-identity as the center of the movement, and the return to itself is the logical consequence of going out of itself, for Tillich. While also maintaining self-identity as the center of the movement, the return to itself is the logical consequence of going out of itself, for Tillich. Life and its ambiguities, what I want to say is that this concept of the interaction between essential and existential being might be a solution to overcome a binary gender model as well as the heteronormativity, because if we consider or davon ausgehen, yeah, if we consider that the being itself is the ground of all being, and essential and existential being are not opposed to each other, perhaps it's eine gewagte These.
It's a daring thesis
that we all have unrealized potentiality, like sexuality, we are in ourselves, and when actualization is influenced by culture, by family, by all these social interactions. And if sexuality is the part of the essential being, there is no reason to call for a heteronormativity, because heterosexuality is also part of the essential, heterosexuality is part of the existential being, the realized being, as well as homosexuality and the essential being. That would mean that in every human being, sexuality is an essential part, and how it comes out, it's also influenced by the culture and social attempts and so on. Is it okay? The first function of life, self-integration, is important because of the self and integrity or the mental integrity of a person. And when we have in pastoral counseling, we are talking, so we have to be aware that, and that's the further step, that every psychic systems have no direct access to each other. It's by Niklas Luhmann system theory, and that is interesting because it results that every psychological self or every psychic system is self-contained and is an expert in his own yeah, and we are not able to know what's the best kind of realization of potential being for the individual person, but only the individual person has the access to the own inner psychological I have to search the word. The internal operations. Luhmann calls it internal operations. And I think I can stop here and perhaps you have questions.